He always thought his destiny was to become a movie star. But then again, so did everyone else who came to Hollywood. It's about a bunch of guys and girls with dreams. They go through Hollywood and make a difference on a lot of people's lives, sometimes without even knowing it. Fame is not what it seems to be. And maybe these people were lucky they didn't achieve it. Maybe not. Think about it. Once you're a star, you have to reprove it every time you go on stage or on camera in public. And if you fail, you're a has-been. We never went to bed worrying about that.
To begin at the beginning. Why do we do it? You have to. It's not you, it's just something that you have to do. You cannot say you want to do or you think you want to. If you think you want to do, then do something else, because it's the payoff's not that great if you view it that way. But it's something that's it's a drug. You're addicted to it. It's something within you. It's becomes your religion, your whole being. And if you don't do it, it's very painful.
No.
I'm not talking about masturbation.
This is a story of a few of the most talented, beautiful, funniest, goofiest people who could have been stars, but you never heard of them. A heartbreak away. An audition to stardom, but unfortunately, it never comes. In this group, they were all talented enough to make it in their field. Comedy, in the case of Shecky Mulligan, the funniest man I ever met. They told him you have to be Jewish to make it in the biz, so he changed his name from Patrick Mulligan to Shecky Mulligan. Music was a field of Rita, the fantastic singer from Kansas, whose the whole world is against me attitude hurt her. David was a brilliant guitar player, a hip, intelligent, eccentric. They all gave up. Maybe if they hadn't. They grew up in the 60s, lived really hard in the 70s, survived the 80s, and came face to face with the 90s. They're my boys, the gang. And for one shining moment, there was Camelot, and it was known as the Performers, a showcase club where they did comedy, acted on camera, and sang on stage. John was a model slash actor slash lawyer slash rugby player slash writer slash producer slash ladies man. He was the instigator who set the tone and orchestrated the whole thing. Bill was a country rebel kid from a small town in Missouri, a totally honest actor and a fine singer who built the eccentric campground called Billville, which was everyone's getaway spot and the place some of the greatest times in their lives occurred. They had the best of times and the worst of times, the highest highs, the lowest lows. They were the dreamers, what we all wished we could be, wanted to be. But they were different. They dared to go for it. Some others resented them, were jealous of them, envied them, and misunderstood them. But still, they tried. In the 50s and 60s, it was Greenwich Village. Since then, it's been in Hollywood, and there were always barriers and obstacles.
The Russians are very sensitive people. Let's try not to offend them.
Fine, we'll make tea.
But still, they tried. They were the baby boomers, the wild children of the 60s who dared to think they could make a difference and dared to think they could change things. They gave their entire soul to the quest. They laughed, cried, loved, and died. They argued and fought. But the laughs are still the times remembered. That's when there was magic in the air. Once upon a time in Hollywood. Just as Camelot reigned when Kennedy was in the White House, Hollywood has had many magical periods. And for this group, it was during the 70s, 80s, and 90s. Once upon a time in Hollywood, there was an acting class on Santa Monica Boulevard in West Los Angeles called The Performers. It was one of the most creative and energetic periods in the Camelot for many of the players. Acting class was weekly, and every other week they were videotaped. After class, there was a singing comedy showcase in the little nightclub in the front of the building. There was a liquor store across the street in a parking lot where the performers summoned their courage to get up in front of the crowd in the spotlight of the dimly lit club. It was beautiful. All these creative people, actors, singers, comedians, dancers, an and all of a sudden we have our own club once a week. The quest of this vagabond group of artists is the stuff books are written about. Their adventures, their friendships, their affairs, and their heartaches are the stuff legends are made of.
First, you gotta remember it was a collection of guys and girls, characters, real Hollywood characters. First of all, there was Coley, John Coleman. He was the leader of the gang. They called him the Instigator, Captain Comfort, frequently the most fun guy they ever met. It was like a giant potluck life, and a huge pot of stew represented sharing life. Everybody had something different to bring to the stew. There was Patrick J. Mulligan, the funniest guy I ever met in my life, bar none, period, exclamation point.
Be seated. All rise. This court is now in session.
Recall the moment and let it come out. That's it, Booby. Let it come. Let it come.
I just can't understand it.
What?
My son Michael's making more money than I am.
Michael who?
Michael Douglas.
Well, what's the problem?
I ain't made a good movie in 15 years.
Oh, just relax. Maybe someday you'll get a movie like No Graves on Boot Hill.
Oh, my God, I think I'm gonna puke.
It's David Lane Walsh, the genius guitar player who, as a boy, was so poor. He lived in a garage for a period with his mother. He was to parlay a house in Venice to a three-building compound in a lake house in Arizona. He was brilliant, cantankerous, defensive. A guitar player.
There's Rita, the absolutely incredible singer from the Midwest who drowns her insecurities in attitude, alcohol, and drugs. There's Lillian Miller, who came from a Norwegian orphanage and appeared on the cover of Playboy 9 times and Inside more than 30.
There was Larry Anderson, a rebel magician who played Lucille Ball's son in her last series, as well as host for The Big Spin and numerous other TV roles.
Bill Clinton, the wild rebel boy from Carthage, Missouri, was a wonderful singer and a totally honest actor. A sensitive soul, he sought truth through Gestalt and other therapies, which ultimately led him to acting classes. Marty Cove, the Brooklyn cowboy who followed his early dream to movie and television stardom. A great lieutenant, but you don't want to have him leading the parade.
Let's not forget the girls. There's Vivian Cove, the beautiful dark-haired New Zealander with the charming accent and voice and charisma that made men fall all over her. There's Carol, the beautiful sidekick problem child with the great sense of humor and need, a gorgeous face and perfect body.
There's Ken Medlock, former pro baseball player who had put in over 20 years as an actor. The smartest baseball and pitching coach ever. He knows the game and could teach it better than anyone. Medlock also saved Coley's life in the celebrated 3-day Mexican jail caper. There's Robert Raymond, the Australian rascal who middleman Schindler's List. There's Bobby Perry, a singer-songwriter with a twinkle in his eye and a bit of Dylan and James Dean. There's Bob and Dana, two really funny comedians who worked at the Comedy Store. Bob was a talented carpenter, jack of all trades, and Dana a beautiful wardrobe girl between their exotic vacations. Bob's sudden unexpected death at 38 gave us all pause and brought us face to face with our own mortality. There's Billy Gordon, the wild character who was the highest-selling greeting card model of all time. A gifted writer of books as well as for the Jackie Mason TV show, Billy had a bright mind, a fabulous sense of humor, the Michigan Wolverine fighting spirit, and Robert.
Let the courtship commence.
Pardon me. Step aside, please. Coming through. Excuse me. Out of the way. Greetings, great prince. Presenting Miss Amani Azee.
This is the story of the Hollywood losers. Some of them had it all, looks, talent, personality. Some of them had some of it, some of them had none of it. But that didn't stop them from getting in the way of the other Hollywood losers who were only a short way from stardom.
The story of Sean. I thought he was kind of a goofball because he partied too hard. He got too high and spoke a different language. but a great athlete. Led the team in home runs at Michigan State University when a teammate was Steve Garvey of the Dodgers. And he could play hoops and shoot like a guard. He and Coley played a lot of one-on-one, and it was 50-50. When whoever was down, it was just that extra little bit that counted. And wow, what a voice. Trained as a child, he could sing with a voice. It was awesome. And a brain. He could win Jeopardy, as he proved over and over as he watched it often. And the skies blue. Do more drugs than anybody, and boy, did he keep up with the times. A good guy, a fun guy, a talented guy. A wild man.
Someone was saying, I love you to me. Your world.
One day I went over to Sean's to see if he wanted to shoot some hoops. He went out and played, and afterwards he told me I saved his life. I never knew what he meant. Then another time the same thing happened.
With empty arms.
And it turns out both times he was just going to shoot up and OD, and he threw the syringes and stuff down the toilet and got rid of it. Because we went to play basketball.
Life is worth living again.
Powerful thing, sports.
For to love you to me is to live. You're one in a million. Chance of a lifetime. A life short compassion. And say. Stroke of love calling you. You're one in a million.
After many years and failed rehab attempts, Sean finally conquered his demons and found peace. Then he found happiness and love with his beautiful wife, Jacqueline.
And send to me a stroke of love for you. One in a million. One in a million. You.
It was one of the greatest times of their lives. Once a week, they'd go into class for a couple hours and do scenes. Every other week, they would videotape the scenes. After acting class was over, the real fun began. About half or more of the people would stay, and some friends would come. And during the half hour before the singing showcase began, people would go through the sheet music with the band, an extremely talented group led by David Lane, an incredible guitarist with the attitude to go with it. The drums, piano, and another guitar. They do a 1 minute key check and run through while everyone else hit the liquor store and the parking lot. The class consisted of some extremely talented singers, scared wannabes, and actors with no musical talent who did it as an acting exercise.
Precious friend, with you I'll always have a friend. You're someone whom I can depend. Walk a path that sometimes ends. Only you can when I need it a
they're dead wrong. I know they are, 'cause I can play this here guitar, and I won't quit till I'm a star on Broadway. I won't quit till I'm a star on Broadway. On Broadway.
I'm Bobby Ratner, and I'm 17 years old. And I drive a Ford pickup because my daddy does. Right, Daddy? Yeah, I'm Vernon Ratner, and I'm 43, and I drive a Ford pickup because my daddy does. Right, Daddy?
Yeah. I'm Burge Ratner, and I'm 71. And I drive a Ford pickup because my daddy does. Right, Daddy?
Comedians emceed the show and did their acts in between. One day, Coley was backstage ready to come out, and all of a sudden he came out in a black chiffon dress and mesh nylons and a feathered boa and wig and said, "Hit it," to the band, and belted out "Take a Walk on the Wild Side" as the band and the crowd went absolutely nuts. At one point, he pulled an apple out of his left bra and took a bite, tossed it into the audience, which was now going crazy. As he continues to sing with blinding spotlights in his eyes, something flashes, and only his right hand at his side turns at the wrist. Without moving his arms or missing a beat, he catches the apple, which has been tossed back. As he exits to wild cheers, he announces to the crowd, "You need me a lot more than I need you," and a legend is born.
Right now, I'd like to introduce a special girl for me. One that's been very close to me for a long time now. She's in the back, but she's coming out quickly. Louise Reed. Let's hear it for her. Come on now. Hey, hey.
This is great.
Isn't she lovely?
Came from Miami, FLA. Hitchhiked away across the USA. Plucked her eyebrows on the plane. Shaved her legs and he was a she. She says, "Hey babe, take a walk on the wild side." Says, "Hey babe, take a walk on the wild side." Sugar Plum Fairy came and hit the streets, looking for soul food and a place to eat. Went to the Apollo, should've seen him go, go, go. He said, "Hey babe, take a walk on the wild side." I said, "Hey babe, take a walk on the wild side." And the color girls go, do, 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 speeding away. Thought she was James Dean for a day. Then I guess she had to crash. Valium would've helped this batch. Says, "Hey babe, take a walk on the wild side." Said, "Hey babe, take a walk on the wild side." Ha ha!
cute. Oh, Judy, you didn't answer correctly. You could have had an empty house.
Goalie put a tape together of modeling, photographs, and commercials to try to break in. Goalie continued to work in small parts and was able to build a demo tape with moving images instead of just still pictures. Goalie had no aspirations as a singer, but used the experience to tear down inhibitions and held them back. It was a painful experience. He was afraid at first. It was a very humbling experience, but he brought fun to it, and he endured and he improved.
The next week, Goalie comes out blackface as an old man with a walker, a gray beard, pillow in his pants, and a shirt, to the tunes of Dixie. He begins to sermonize about how he understood what was going on with all this sex and drugs and disco. I was young once too. He told the band to hit it. Barry White's rendition of Can't Get Enough of Your Love inspired him to dance his ass off.
No matter how I try, it's like the more you give, the more I want. And baby, that's no lie. How can I explain all the things I feel? Girl, you're giving me so much. Girl, you're so unreal still.
Goalie was real serious about learning the craft of acting. He analyzed it like a lawyer and approached it like an athlete. He worked at it. He worked hard at his craft. One night a week was Harvey Lembeck, the only genius who could teach comedy. Another night was an improvisation class, and another night a scene study class. The performers were your videotaped scenes in acting class and could sing afterward in the nightclub up front. It was the place to have fun and work out. It was our playground. Place to try out things learned in the other classes.
God, if I could only make you see and make you understand. God, your love for me is all I need and more than I can stand. Oh, yeah, baby.
I love show business, honey.
The buzz was on. How could Coley ever top that? What would he do next week? In a perfect costume, Superman strides to the stage. With hands on his hips, he stands like a tower of strings while the boom, 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 boom of a bass guitar like a tom-tom continues to crescendo. And Superman, the man of steel, breaks into Johnny Get Angry, his gay lament to a friend. As the prissy man of steel finishes, he admonishes Johnny. Don't tell anybody about this, okay?
Biggest lecture I ever had. I'm on a brave man, I'm on a caveman. Johnny, tell me that that you care, really care for me.
Was raging, and everybody looked forward to Wednesday night with great anticipation.
Coley thought of this thing called a group song so they could sing more and play longer.
Does everybody know how to get to my house?
No.
Yeah, I gave him directions.
You know how to get there?
Johnny, why don't you give us some directions?
Come in the back room, take your clothes off, and I'll show you a map, baby.
And then what do I do?
We're gonna get there.
At the end of the night, after a final group song, most would move to a local bar or pub until it closed, and then finish off at someone's house or apartment, often Coley's or David's. This went on for almost 2 years, during which time the actors, comedians, and singers rode the roller coaster of their artistic careers, with a few working at some professional level, while others' hearts were crushed in the quest. One of the great rides of their lives.
Coley usually carried a tape recorder and taped everything. Vivian wanted to sing, but she didn't have any sheet music, so Coley let her take her pick of his. And then she didn't know the words and felt unprepared and kind of froze on stage. Coley cajoled everyone into helping her out, and it turned out to be a fun song. So much fun, we just didn't want it to end.
Please, 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 please tell me that you're gone. Daddy don't mind, and your mama don't mind. I just have another time, just one more time.
I love Perry Walsh's music, and put together a team to make a video of Burning Candles. In the middle of the shoot, the director of photography, who talked his way into directing, stole the videotape and changed the music.
This one is for lonely lovers' hearts. Sometimes I'm
This is the new version called Heartbreaker, which coincided with the breakup of John and Carol. Through the sands of time, bittersweet memories of time past. Why?
Never forget you.
part of me, part of us that will live forever frozen in our hearts. I hope it makes you smile for the rest of your years. The bittersweet memory, a thing called the distant past.
There are a few others in the class, not actors, but tortured souls who are using the class to help free themselves of inhibitions. In 1981, a guy named Bill Clinton invited Coley to go camping. After turning him down 14 times, Coley went and loved Bill's paradise. One day, after going sailing with some friends, including an actress and her current, as well as former husband, they had so much fun they didn't want it to end, so they went to a Chinese restaurant, and a fantastic time made other diners jealous. To ease the pain of parting such an incredible fun time, Coley suggested they go camping at Billville the next weekend, and everyone wholeheartedly agreed. And another place that would become magic to them all came into their lives. Billville. You drive 2.5 miles up an incredible incline up a mountain to a final 8 blocks of dirt road with ruts so big, rocks 2 feet in diameter put into a hole to make it better. Many a mufflers were lost on the last block.
No matter how well we planned or how early we tried to get to camp, we were always delayed by something.
Right. Never fucking get there. Come on, lady! Fuck! Hey, lady! What is your fucking problem? Stupid bitch! Listen to me a second. You and I made a deal, all right? Don't fuck with me like this. It's business. Business is business, Charlie. Friendship has nothing to do with it, all right? No, listen. Just shut up a minute, will you? Listen to me. Are you either with the program or you're not with the program? Now, which is it? All right, when I get in, I want everybody smiling, spit and polish, all right?
Billville is 11 acres high on a mountain overlooking Lake Isabella. It looks like rough cowboy country with mesquite, huge rocks everywhere. The creek has 3 waterfalls and an above-ground cavern. It is absolutely beautiful. There are caves with Indian petroglyphs, a swing out over the valley, and a deck that hangs out over the valley with a 100-foot drop. Billville, where we camped, we hiked, we made love, we fought, we laughed and laughed and laughed. We did mushrooms, pot, and alcohol, and we laughed some more.
What was Billville like, Daddy?
Well, Billville, initially known as Scruffy Bill's Vagina Gulch, was a campsite on 11 acres of rock and dirt that looked like a set in a Western movie. It was on a creek 2.5 miles up the mountain from a big white water river that ran through the small towns nearby, which attracted campers, rafters, as well as bikers. This is where Bill invited John Coleman 14 times before he finally came, after which he came 6 times in 8 months. And later invited the key players to go camping, and our incredible artist retreat happened for 10 years. 2 hours and 45 minutes outside of L.A. in the
80s and 90s. Several of the people said that top 10 times in their lives, at least two or three were at Millville. It was a spiritual place where people went to enjoy the nature and find themselves. As with the times, natural drugs and alcohol also had their place to play in that period. The story of Millville is the funny times, the confrontations, the lessons, and the love shared that shows everyone's a true star. It's the big chill done in the spirit of Full Monty.
Well, all right. Where does one begin in the saga of Millville? Well, let's pick it up at Summerfest 85, the Kern River. A liver runs through it.
Summerfest 85, the Kern River, a liver runs through it. Summer officially kicks off the Memorial Day weekend at Millville. That's where the bulk of my LA friends commiserate, cocktail and camp. Millville is definitely Disneyland for adults. This rugged Sierra Nevada mountain range has streams, woods, and the mighty Kern Rivers makes for a bitchin' backdrop for dropping acid mushrooms and ecstasy or whatever else you got. Although, I bet heroin probably isn't a camping drug. Nodding out and roasting marshmallows are mutually exclusive activities. And coke in the woods, no good. Tried it, hated it. The games associated with coke are more conducive for urban partying. Ask my wife and the Kennedys. Along with the recreational drugs, the accompaniment of beer, wine, whiskey, liquor, and the almighty doob is essential. Your liver will get a workout at Millville, because we want to blow you up. That's not to say that you couldn't have a great time with these elixirs, but I wasn't about to make that kind of bold experimentation. That's some brave stuff going to Millville straight. Memorial Day weekend 85 was kind of special. I introduced my Hollywood pals to Millville. Bob and Dana, parties extraordinaire. Larry Anderson, my good showbiz buddy, and his lovely Aussie paramour, Lila, came up too. And of course, my beach pals, Coleman, who I nicknamed Colin, his girlfriend Carol, Dave Walsh, the groove merchant of Venice, and his chick Rita were there too. Marty Cove, Karate Kid, and his Aussie wife with a killer culo. Vivian made it up as well. Also, several other regulars, which included parents, kids, dogs, and of course, the host of this grand debauchery, Bill Clinton. And I'm not talking about the ex-president. Setting up camp was just, with Brian Crystal was great, just a little bit. She being more of a man than I, she did most of the work. She liked being in charge, so I would assist. Making camp usually took about 3 beers. I was accompanied by Mine Crystal. Setting up camp, Mine Crystal was great. Her being more of a man than I, she did most of the work. I may be tricky, but she's dicky. She liked being in charge, so I would assist. Making camp usually took about 3 beers and a couple of lines of coke, 2 hits of glue and some Drano.
Then we would adjourn to the center of camp. Bill literally built his fort equipped with a rustic kitchen, picnic fucking table, an area for coolers, boom boxes, and a hammock for chilling. All under a huge pine tree for shade.
From another huge pine nearby was a swing. The swing can take you from the top of this ravine and swing you out some 70 feet. Oh. Well, God forbid the swing would break, for it would mean certain paralysis or death for some unlucky camper.
Oh, excuse me. Near the center of camp was this deck, see? It was erected off the cliff that looks over the scenic view. Am I boring you? I'm sorry. Above the deck is a huge stone fireplace. After a hard day of hiking and tubing and partying, that's where we'd usually commence to fuckwad and entertain. Oh, there was one other thing. That fuckwad fest would usually include anything from an innocent Beatles sing-along that would last for hours. And it would also include some costume soirees, compliments of Coleman's closet. Lots of costumes, because he is a big faggot. I'm sorry, am I bothering you? One time, Colin wore a Superman suit, see? He got phenomenally drunk as he stood above this big rock stove with his cape blowing in the wind, In one hand, he had a burger. In the other hand, he had a bottle of barbecue sauce. He would eat the burger, then chase it down with some barbecue sauce. He could barely stand. It was too perfect. I called him Stuperman.
Second, who are these people who go to camp without drugs? Second order of business on this killer sunny day, the obligatory trip to the stream below. It's a steep hike down to the stream. Off to the right is an area great for washing up and brushing your teeth. The brisk, clear waters of this mountain stream rushes over and around large rocks. Great for basking in the hot California sun.
Burn Center Bob was really grooving. Basking in the sun rocks, I was admiring my Crystal's legs while she smoothed sunscreen on them. She used a lot of sunscreen. She had a lot of leg. Dave, Rita, and Colin's girlfriend, Carol, were getting restless. There was still so much to explore in this ravine o'plenty. Dave whipped out some mushrooms, and I whipped out some beers. Colin whipped out some doobage while Bob played Tears for Fears. We gathered and split to another magical place we call the Falls. It's a fairly challenging hike through the stream that twists and turns its way down between these huge boulders, jumping from rock to rock, over boulders and through the stream that was gaining momentum. It was no easy task. As we carried all our creature comforts, coolers, boombox, towels, dope, you know, the essentials. A downward trend gave way for a marvelous view below. Deep blue sky had but a few puffy white clouds. This ravine, carved from centuries of erosion, made for some trippy scenery. Canyon-like rocks lie askew as if they had tumbled from some prehistoric earthquake. Layers of mineral deposits made radical lines across these majestic boulders, one for miles. This natural phenomenon struck me profound. Mother of Nature is a motherfucker. That's not the drugs talking either. As the mushrooms kicked in, my energy grew. Breathing was joyous, and soon I started babbling like this brook that was now a small river. This mini river had transformed into a waterfall, the falls, one of the great hangs. The water tumbles down to a dark little cove. The pool in this black stone cove is icy. The water spills from this pool, creating a larger pool, a sandbar of sorts. The water is shallow, and some of the people wading in it were too. And soon, it descends and continues on, taking the shape of a mountain stream again. To the left of this sandbar is a steep boulder, the actual entrance to the falls. The boulder is carved perfectly as if it were tailor-made, with nooks and crannies great for climbing or lounging. The Sierra Nevada sun is hot and the water is cold, creating a wonderful contrast that bombards the senses. On mushrooms, it's a fucking trip. And then when you add your LA crazies to this scenario, it's a recipe for big grins, great banter, and laugh until you puke fun. Larry did the old balls across the face routine there. Colin told us the story of how he fed cat food as hors d'oeuvres at this Christmas party. I was there, and when Colin announced to his very unsuspecting guests that he had duped them, there was a certain gasp. On one hand, Colin had sponsored this Christmas party, but on the other, he had fed us poison. I duly noted that Colin giveth Christmas and Colin taketh it away. For some reason, Larry waxed indignant, see? This cat food prank put a bad taste in Larry's mouth. He vowed privately to me that he would wax vindictive. Am I getting too much wax buildup here? Anywho, one night, Colin got too drunk and passed out. Larry dropped his trowel and rested his genitalia on Colin's face while I snapped away with my Canon 35mm. It was a late night, and the cold night air put a little chill on Larry's dick, shrinking it considerably.
Well, this was a reference to Larry's genitalia. Apparently, it was large enough to make a huge bulge. In a later trip to Billville, Larry would give us all a glimpse of his basket firsthand as he took advantage of another photo opportunity.
So, we vowed to come up with a revenge plan. So he's laying there, and we're all feeling a little childish ourselves. So we said, what can we do to get revenge on John? So he's laying there. We go up. We figure we will get some lipstick. We'll draw all over his face. We'll do all that stuff. So we did do that, actually. Got a magic mark or something.
Yeah, everybody participated.
Yeah, we have all of us. But then after we had them all painted like some, you know, some fucking banshee. We thought, this is not enough. We got to get something else. So we said, one of us, I don't know who that idea was, one of us ought to put his dick in John's mouth and we could get a picture of him. So we're all looking at each other, standing over John as he's laying there, you know. And we're all looking at each other saying, who's going to be brave enough to whip out their dick? Of course, obviously the guy with the biggest dick is going to do it. Because, you know, he's got nothing to hide.
But he chose not to, so Larry,
So I decided it would be me. And so I did. I pulled out my my genitalia and lowered it slowly onto John's face, and worried that he might be overhearing this and that he might like grab a hold of it. I was a little bit cautious, but so I let it shrivel up a little bit just to draw back in case, you know. It was a cold morning. It was a cold night.
No inclination whatsoever.
And who took the picture?
And I don't know. Did you take the picture?
Of course.
Chucky took the picture. He had one of those little
cameras. I still have the roll of film.
Yeah, it has a negative and everything, doesn't it? Silly me. I should have, you know, made sure it was a Polaroid or something without a negative. And it's Chucky's camera with a negative. This story eventually actually came back to backfire on me, much more so than it did John Cole. We ended up with a picture of my balls on his face, and lots of lipstick on it. Looked like he had a really
These idiots thought they put me down. They didn't know that I was awake the whole time. I pretended to be asleep. I didn't move a muscle nary unless they realized I was the one who was capping them.
So we have a picture of John's my balls on his face, and that surfaced at a number of parties subsequent to that. It was always posted on Shecky's bulletin board, and I would go in, and it was there supposedly to embarrass John. But I go in and everybody's looking at my balls, which, as we said, it was a cold morning that day.
And people were going, they go,
"There's a shrivel factor.
Who's that guy with Larry's balls?" They kept, you know, that was like,
I don't understand.
My balls were more famous than his.
Somehow they figured it was some kind of a put down. I mean, I figure I got them.
So that's the balls across the face story. And someday, when I get my, you know, get my sitcom and I'm starring in my own movie or sitcom, that's going to show up in the Enquirer or the Star magazine.
Tell us about one of the times you got caught cheating.
Cheating? On who?
One of the guys that used to go out. Bruce, Kevin, Henry.
I don't think I ever got caught cheating.
Tell us about a few of the times you got away with it.
What's that got to do with Bill-Dum?
Nothing.
Oh, yeah. You just gather and videotape.
Biographical background.
Yeah, no.
Biographical background. We need a little history.
Tell you about my felony records. Tell you about my felony records.
That's it. We want to hear about
Minnesota felony records.
Go for it.
Yeah. I was mixed up with a bad crowd. I always mixed up, but that's why I'm making this video. It's mixed up with a bad crowd.
From Billville, the gang would venture out. We'd load up a couple of vehicles with goodies, tunes, libation, tubes, and head down to the Kern River. Cohen usually had a convertible, so I made sure I procured a spot for me and my chick. The ride from Billville to the main road is a bit radical. It's a steep, dirt mountain road loaded with bumps and turns. Once on the main road, the ride to Kernville is about 5 miles. Kernville is a quaint little town that's usually jammed in the summer with campers and bikers. The river runs through it. The upper Kern, at this point, is fairly swift and great for tubing. Not everyone in our group has a tube, so Cullen had to work his magic. He's a great scam artist and very, very persuasive. In his day, he had movie star good looks. He worked hard on keeping a bronze tan, which made his teeth look pearly white. Nowadays, his tans have turned his face into a wallet, and his teeth are brown from all the resin.
Hey!
But I digress. As he flashes his tennis pro smile, he'd ask a local tuber if he could borrow their tube. He managed to procure enough tubes for everybody. The tube ride down the stretch of the Kern was exhilarating, exciting, and above all, way fun. It's a giggle fest that certainly brings out the kid in you. We tubed down to an area called Disneyland. It was a fairly precarious drop in the river, loaded with bumps, turns, surrounded by low, sharp tree branches. So if you fell out of your tube, you could get hurt. This ride lasts for about 2 minutes and is really, really addictive. Your first inclination is to go back and do it again and again and again, which we did. And of course, we did, again and again and again. This time, Colin and Carol lost control, went under, and were separated from their tubes. First order of business, rescue the tubes. I scooped up one and Burn Center grabbed the other. Colin and Carol had to brave this bumpy ride down this bumpy water with sans tube. Onward, the river slows a bit as we enter an area with a walkover bridge. Dangling from this bridge is a rope great for swinging, and we swung. On one run, all the guys piled on the rope, swung out some 30 feet. Apparently the weight was too much. The rope broke and we all tumbled into the river. I'll tell you, some kids standing nearby were next in line on the rope, you know? Kids. Well, the decent thing to do would be to go rescue the rope, go up to the bridge and retie it. Oh, fuck that, I'm telling you. These kids whined and whined. Fuck them too. Onward. We gathered and walked back to Kernville. We turned the tubes, jumped in our sleds, and booked up to the river to Kelly's hole. Kelly is not a girl, and the hole has nothing to do with what you're thinking, you filthy pig. This would be the most magical place on the Kern. More on those acid trips later, but first, this acid trip. Bikers, mountain men, and the drag queen. Colin was great fodder for campfire folklore. On one occasion, we reminisced about a classic Colin story. Got up early one morning and decided to drop some acid. How strange. The usual bunch were at Billville. We loaded up and went cruising up past Kelly's Hole to Johnny's. Johnny McNally monopolized this area of the Kern. A gas station, general store, campgrounds, and there was also a bar restaurant. The bar was usually packed with locals and tourists, many of which were bikers. We pulled in for some drinks. There was a patio in the back which overlooked the river. We all gathered around and ordered stuff. We passed some time as we noticed that Colin wasn't around. Not that that was a bad thing, but he did have the keys to the convertible. Suddenly, there was a commotion in the bar, cheering, laughing, catcalls. On investigation, we found that the biker crew had 15 to 20 guys, and they were all huddled around this broad. Well, that broad was Colin. Colin was a big fan of the movie Tootsie. He'd get dressed up and drag whatever he could. Well, what could be more appropriate at a biker bar? I must say that it took some balls. And while I'm on the subject, the boys at the bar had a bet going. Did this Bonnie lass with the maid makeup have a twat, or did she have balls? They were buying this new girl in town plenty of drinks to find out. At one point, this big, fat, grungy local who'd come from a long line of inbreeding got his arm up Colin's dress and grabbed himself a handful, if you know what I mean. This big mongoloid put the squeeze on him, too. Colin's face began to show signs of why the fuck did I do this? He then told the smelly mountain man to maybe squeeze someone else, like maybe him, as he pointed to me. The mongoloid mountain man grabbed me and put me into a headlock. As he put the squeeze on, Colin yells out, "Harder!" I'm still blazing on the acid. Being in this position was quite uncomfortable. And Colin yells out, "Harder!" again. I can hear my neck cracking at this point and I'm choking. Paranoia, no, panic, starts setting in now. Being in a classic headlock position, my head was in the area just above the guy, this fucking goon's belly. Well, the creature probably hadn't wiped his ass in his life, and it smelled, the smell down there was abominable. Again, Colin yells out, "Harder!" And again, the cretin squeezes me yet harder. At this point, I'm starting to black out. I thought for sure this blackout would involve a dirt nap. This scumbag was so strong, I couldn't budge at all. So to maybe squirm out, you know, out of his chokehold, see? Yeah. And of course, everyone at the bar, including my so-called pals, were all laughing it up, see? This is it. I'm dead, as my neck cracks again. I don't know why this moron stopped when he did, but he finally let go, see? And as I dropped to the floor, my last thought was a plan to get even with Colin for this. His worst practical joke on me, see? When I came to, everyone was still laughing and cheering, see? Apparently, they thought I was acting. Figured. I got up and staggered over to my Krista for support, see? She took me out to this patio and went back in to give this mountain boy a piece of her mind. All that brought on more uproarious laughter, see? I shook it off and ordered another drink. The rest of the gang were caught up in the circus inside. Oh, geez, Dad, I shook it off and ordered another drink, huh? The rest of the gang were too caught up in the circus inside, dear. More of my revenge in an upcoming chapter. Shecky's revenge, dear. Huh? Well, more of my revenge in an upcoming chapter called Shecky's Revenge.
To says, hey, babe, take a walk in the wild side.
What did you say?
Says, hey, babe, take a walk in the wild side.
And with everything that's going on in the world, you sit down and you decide to write about the goddamn armory exhibit of 1913.
I'm sorry. I was out trying to earn a living, all right? Come on now. Can we stop this?
Oh, God, what are you doing?
Let's just say we're taking a flying fuck at a rolling dome.
Maybe if you took yourself more seriously, other people would too.
Well, if you just look kind of close, I think you'll find me hiding behind my zipper.
I don't give a damn.
I want you to be free.
Tell me why I should give a damn.
To finish.
I don't give a damn. I don't give a damn!
Said so.
Well, take off your clothes.
Look, I'm not.
Look, you started this whole thing. You're not gonna chicken out on me now. Take off your clothes.
What are you gonna do, rape me?
Yeah.
The Billville party was one of the most beautiful things I've ever been associated with. It was just like the movie It's a Wonderful Life. Bill got in trouble and the county told him he had to build a sewer or dig a well. Or do some fixing up that would cost $10,000 or they're going to tear down all his structures and not let him back up there. Well, the gang pitched him and threw a surprise party that raised almost $4,000 for him. Boy, what an incredible night.
It's a Wonderful Life came true in Hollywood on July 28, 1988.
David Walsh is a musical genius, and the world should hear his music.
I was a pony on a carousel, carrying fair maidens safely on home. You've got my fancy, I've tried to settle down, build a little home and put roots in the ground. But it was all just make-believe, life in the moon. A soldier of pirates, a lover and a thief, a few of the faces that they painted on me. Well, you straighten up and fly right, sail on home to live. Temptation was so sweet and such a bitter pill, and it was all too short for me, my life in the movies. Alimony and anger round my neck, my marriage is on the rocks and my love is shipwrecked.
about Billville.
Yeah.
Bill Clinton, who once said to Ben Furman, "Should we have another beer before breakfast?"
Praise Jesus. Friends, what does Billville mean to me?
Hey, I didn't bother you when you were taking a dump in your diapers.
Amen, brother. Say to you, amen now, Lord. See you in hell. Going to Billville means to me, also means to hang out with John Coleman. A real great guy. And I'm not just saying that because you're a big movie star now either, I swear. Hey, John, you're a real neat guy. Can I come over to your house, please? Some people would say that the reason John Coleman has bad knees. Hi, John. Georgie Taps here. Bend over. Get a shrimp, John. Bend over. Get a shrimp.
Awesome. I got the Midwest sawdust running through my veins. The sound of eastbound trucks and a westbound train.
Rita, a small-town Kansas girl, had the voice of a tornado, and she could rip it up with the best of them.
My soul was designed and made. I'm an American rocker, born with the beat, raised on the blues. American rocker, from my motorcycle jacket to my blue suede shoes. I got a Fender guitar and a 60 Chevrolet. Now both of them invented in the USA. That rebel twang and treble is the sound I love to hear. A VA pumping cylinders of music to my ears. I'm an American rocker, born with the beat, raised on the blues. American rocker, from a motorcycle jacket to my blue suede shoes. Played in Japan, of course they understand exactly what you're trying to say. Germany, England, Holland, and France, the language never gets in the way. I've been around the world in limousines and jets, but nothing can compare to the place I love best. From New York City all the way to L.A., my heart starts beating when I hit the highway. I'm an American rocker, born with the beat, raised on the blues. American rocker, from my motorcycle jacket to my blue suede shoes.
myself today. How could I make it more complicated? I thought I need to make it more sophisticated and more need to make it difficult to understand so that nobody will like really get it. And I tried to change it, but then I realized that, you know, Maureen, you idiot, it's perfect exactly as it is.
There we go, that's that one there. Now I'm gonna take the other ends over here and untie them equally the same, and then drop this so we have, in fact, a chain of three ropes tied together at the ends, thusly. Now, so far, I can see you're underwhelmed, but let's see if the trick happens.
First, what magic?
Yep, thank you. Gene's doing all the class. Of course, there would be no magic if, in fact, I didn't have a magic wand or a magic coin. I have one somewhere buried in the bottom of my pocket. It is a 50-cent piece, and it's amongst all these other little magic articles here. Young lady, would you please hold on to the end of that rope? I will take the coin, which is here, and wave this over the top. Say the magic words. Bill, Bill, if you would. Very good. Now, you see, you end up with one nice, long piece of rope.
All right, just one other thing. This tune is called... Hey! All right, this song is really about what I'm trying to suppress right here. The childlike spontaneity that we all seem to lose as we go along, and it's called Who Turns the Horses Round.
This song is about dreaming, and since that's what this is all
about, I hope I can,
about,
you can hear my finger picks.
Trying to manifest your dream.
Okay.
Thank you.
Fuck all you good people.
Why don't we tell it like it is? This is We Hate Bill Clinton, but we like his property tonight. We like his property. The rest of us fuck up and get in trouble. What happens? People kick our ass. We have a party for Bill. Bail him out. What the hell is this? It's A Wonderful Life, for Christ's sake. You're a goddamn crybaby. Pay your bills. Get your land. Some fucking friend, he invites us over and asks us to pay 3 years later. You think I'm jealous? People give me shit all the time. You're a nut. You should be committed. The rest of us know that. We're sane. What's your goddamn problem?
I don't know. It just, fuck this bullshit.
You know what this asshole did when I was in the hospital? He paid $30 to send me a bouquet of dead roses with a little note that says, I hate you. My father said, don't say anything. Maybe it just got there late.
Continued to work and had a short foray into the restaurant business as well.
I'll put you back in. Is that all right with you, Max?
Sure. Fine by me.
They just saw you on live TV, thought you were so bad, they decided to cancel your appearance.
Hey, I go over Niagara Falls in a wall safe, and now this.
Well, I'll just go put this with your things.
Well, how about it, Alexander? Now that the whole country is watching, why don't you get on with your escape?
Yes. My escape. Yes. Well, it's time now for my escape. The one that you've been waiting for all along. Live on national television. My escape. It's time for the amazing Alexander's great escape.
trapped in a 2-bit jail cell. I'm ruined.
I hate when people say that.
Fallen hero? Ladies and gentlemen, jail cells and locks and chains are for criminals. And it would be criminal for the amazing Alexander to be kept locked up and not capture the new world's record. So I invite you to stand back as the amazing Alexander presents his most amazing escape ever!
He's gone! You let a confessed criminal out of your custody. You're through, babe.
I wouldn't be so quick to condemn your lovely sheriff. I may be out of the jail cell, but I am still in custody. Look, lady, I don't know who you are, but I'm James Dixon.
I was engaged to James Dixon. And you would be well advised to start explaining what you're doing here before I call the police.
Fine. Why don't you just bring in the police? I'd like to talk to them myself. All right, what'd you do with my phone?
Stop it. This was never your apartment.
Diana.
Listen, if there's anyone you should be talking to, it sounds like it should be this fiancé of yours.
Diana's fiancé is dead.
I'm sorry. Look, I don't know anything about your fiancé, but if I find out he was living in my apartment, I am not going to be too happy about that. But if showing you some identification will make
I don't
you...
want to see your identification. Anyone can fake ID.
Listen, I'm getting a little tired of this, all right? I come in here and I find my apartment has been cleaned out and there are two people standing, two strangers standing in the middle of it, and now I'm the one who's
all
on
right,
top...
All right, why don't we just calm down?
I don't want to calm down. I want to know who the hell you are.
You know, well, I want to find out who cleaned out my apartment.
James, I thought you were dead.
Oh, God.
Diana, now come on. Get a hold of yourself. Now, come on.
I'm not lying.
Diana, take a deep breath. Okay? Now calm down. Come on.
All right, look. You said that anyone can fake an ID, right? All right. Well, I would have had to fake a whole wallet full, okay? Here is my driver's license. And here is a credit card. And another credit card. And here's my Red Cross blood donor's card.
Thank you, okay? Thank you. Look, do you mind if I ask you what kind of line of work you're in?
No, I'm a salesman.
Okay, did your company have anything to do with the medical community?
No, we sell natural fruit drinks. Why?
Well, did you ever have anything to do with medicine or science or research?
No.
You never saw that man before?
I'm sorry. Excuse me, man.
Yeah.
Excuse me, miss. Look, it's obvious that you have a big stake in this, and I just hope that you can get to the bottom of it.
Fielding, I have to tell you, these last 2 weeks in front of the camera have done wonders for your runoff campaign.
Dan Fielding, state assemblyman. I like the ring of that.
Of course, as your media consultant, I have to tell you, we're still fighting a perception problem with the electorate.
What does that supposed to mean?
People don't like you. I'm telling you, I've never seen a drop like this. In the last hour, your standing in the polls has dropped 30 points.
How do you get results that fast?
It was a phone survey. As soon as people heard your name, they hung up.
It's all over?
Yeah. Darn. I was hoping we could milk the spotlight for a little damage control.
Don't worry about it, Fleming. Most voters are drooling mouth breathers with the minds of gnats anyway.
Dan?
Huh?
Camera's still on.
Hey, hey! You got the lightning round.
Stop this.
But we saved the best for last. Sheena? Aren't we devils? Okay, Judy, the lightning round is fairly simple. As our new winner, you get a spin on the wheel and 5 quick questions. Answer them all correctly, and you win! Miss one. And slice.
Slice!
Are you ready? Okay, Judy, your favorite category, light. Can we have the timer, please? All right, let's go! Who, when he proposed, promised to be the keeper of your dreams?
He meant it.
Who did?
Tom.
Yes! Number two, who said he'd never make you live with his parents?
He tried. I should be more understanding.
Who was it?
Tom.
Yes!
But I'm winning. The blade's still going down.
Number three, who forgot your birthday? Who never takes you out anymore?
He's under a lot of pressure.
Oh, he's under a lot more than that, Judy. Answer the question. The clock is ticking. Yes!
If I win, he dies.
Who do you love?
Tom.
And lastly, who do you want out of your life?
I never meant that.
I said, who do you want out of your life?
You!
Oh, Judy, you didn't answer correctly. You could have had an empty house.
Coley's movie career took him all over Europe and to Africa.
You get along well with Mrs. Reed.
Jealous?
You think they can leave me alone? Without anybody to love me? Nobody talks to me. Nobody loves me.
What's your name?
Angel.
It's okay, Angel. Don't cry.
He told me all about my old friend Sam.
Just what did Rogers tell you?
Just about the funniest thing I ever heard. Something about the United States of South America with Mendoza as El Presidente. You guys gotta be kidding. Go on, Sam. Tell me you did it out of conviction. That it wasn't the money. There's one round in the chamber. You owe it to Carol and Susan. You are my friend, Sam. My best friend. I was always better than you. But you never knew when to give up. It's a little like tequila, only stronger. I like it. Very nice. You come here often?
Never. Just looking at this place would set me back 3 months' pay. Okay. Maybe it's about time you told me who you really are and what's going on.
Simplify things. Let's just say I was sent on a mission with the Congressional Inquiry Committee, and the cards were marked. You know the rest. Everyone was killed. Your father found me and took me in. There were people after me. Still mad.
Hiya, Billy boy! What do you want?
Looks like Billy's got company.
Yeah, nice company. What are we celebrating, Billy boy? How come you didn't invite us?
Hey. She's a cute little thing, isn't she, Charlie?
Where are your manners? Ain't you gonna introduce us?
Oh, she's nothing but skin and bones.
Get your hands off me. Leave her alone! Hey, just relax, kid.
Hey, Charlie. Look at this.
Billy boy's freaking than we gave him credit for.
Are you guys into instrument?
It's called bondage. Clean up.
Sure, Charlie. Anything Billy wants.
Stop!
Where's the rest of the company? One day you can only use it. This isn't a social call, Consuela. Your father was killed tonight. Murdered. It's my fault. Killers came to the shack and he refused to tell them where I was. I've got to go north tomorrow to meet a friend. We'll leave first thing in the morning.
Coley continued to work, had several books published, and made a number of documentary films.
Hi, I'm John Coleman. Wouldn't it be great if you could just pop a video cassette in the VCR and relive the greatest memories of your life? Well, this book does the next best thing. It really takes you slow dancing with your memories. My Life, a Personal Memoir, collects all your memories in this beautiful book to enjoy and relive as often as you wish. Outside of one's friends and family, the greatest things in a person's life are his memories. Unfortunately, because we're so busy living, we often don't spend enough time appreciating the wonderful life we've had. A baby book is among the most familiar volumes on the shelves of millions of homes, with our birth weight, first words, and early achievements lovingly inscribed by mom. Later, some of us keep personal diaries and record trips and graduations and family photo albums. But with the passing years, few of us take time to reflect who we really are and what really matters to us, to record our unforgettable memories that imbue our lives with a sense of meaning and continuity. My Life, a Personal Memoir is, in reality, a do-it-yourself autobiography. The perfect gift for mom, dad, grandparents, friends, spouses, or anybody else. This intimate album enables us to record our personal lives and values, to relive in words and pictures the meaningful moments that make it all worthwhile. It's not a diary, it's not a journal, you don't write sentences or paragraphs, just words and phrases. It's a catalog of all the important, significant, interesting, and great memories of your life. It'll fit perfectly alongside the family photo album. You don't write your autobiography, you just fill it in and smile. To order now, call the number on your screen, 1-800-959-8889. That's 1-800-959-8889. Do yourself a favor.
Shecky continued to work also.
May I take your drink orders?
No.
Would you like to hear the specials?
No.
Would you like to hear a couple of tunes from West Side Story?
Oh, double, double cheese, cheeseburger, burger, please.
It's always a good time.
Hey, who ate all the crab puppies?
Now, the first order of business is to divide ourselves into patrol teams.
As long as we're dividing up into teams, why don't we get up a softball game?
Hey, huh? Let's play
softball. Now, here's a dancer for you, Mr. Jack Nicholson.
You welcome Larry Anderson. Larry. You used to, Ed was doing his pitch tonight for the Morris Metric Slicer that he used to sell on the boardwalk in Atlantic City. You used to do one of those?
Forget about the $2. Right now, the early bird special. Yes, I did.
What did you sell?
I sold Miracle Slicers.
Miracle Slicers,
mops, pots and pans, the Ginsu knife, and TV magic cards, which
is
the first thing I sold because that was it was right out of magic into the trick cards, and that's opened up the whole field of
pitching. Do one of the spiels, whichever one you want. Hustle, something.
Okay. Watch this if you haven't seen it, fellas and squirrels, or girls. Let me show you how to make a deck of cards. Walk, talk, jump through a hoop, tap, dance, snort, and do everything but write home for money. If you haven't already seen it, if you don't understand how it works or why I work, Just as soon as I can gather a small but interested crowd of about 10 or 15,000 people, more or less. Sometimes I have more, most often less. Show you a trick that I had the pleasure of performing in the insane asylum just last week. They went crazy for me there. Bad Joe. I don't write them, I just tell them, you know.
Radar.
For the first trick, can I move this over here?
Sure.
For the first trick, young man. That's you. Okay. Young man. Would you read?
Yes.
Just pretend, Johnny.
Yes, I will. What do you want me to do?
How old are you, young man?
11.
11 years old. If I have the two, it can't be under the box. Would you turn that card over, Snotty? Or Sonny?
The nine of diamonds. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. That's good.
Every deck comes with instructions for 12 different tricks. There's an insurance policy. You lose an arm or a leg, we'll help you find it. It's $2 a deck, and it goes on. And you explain how this deck works. It's a trick deck, and you sell it for $2 and then get out of town fast.
Really?
Came out, fame and fortune, found some success as an actor, and then the most scary thing happened in my life. I auditioned for a part as a game show host. And I knew that there was going to be problems if I decided not to be an actor and to be a game show host, because in my mind there would be no going back once I decided to be a game show host. There would be the acting career. If it were successful, I was going to kiss it goodbye. So I went through this great turmoil, this inner turmoil about, do I become a game show host? And it happened to coincide with the Memorial Day festivities at Billville, and I was in a total funk. Didn't come out of my tent. For the moments I did come out of my tent, I was gloomy and depressing and all that. And everybody's, what's wrong with Larry? What's wrong? Did his family member die? No, he's going to be a game show host. He can't decide whether to be a game show. I was very depressed at the time. I think I got over it the next day. Had a few beers.
No. It lasted for the whole weekend.
The whole weekend?
Larry looked into the fire like a weird animal.
That was a real bummer. Yeah, I was staring into the fire a lot, looking at the...
God help me, please. Not success. Cinders. Not success.
Yeah, I can't.
Not financial
success. I know
security.
I'll make a lot of money as a game show host, but God, there goes the acting career. Now, I'd give anything just to be a game show host again. I just finished doing a short-lived series with Lucille Ball, and I thought that was going to be the thing that shot me. Here I am with this great superstar of sitcom, and I'll ride the coattails of her success, and the show will be a big hit. Show wasn't, and that's immediately on the heels of that, the job offer for game show came, and it was just this big decision. But working for Lucy, it was great. I had the best time, and as I said, I had my hopes high that this was going to be my launching pad into success. And,
tough luck, pal. What was the highlight?
It's time to play Fruit or Consequences.
Thank you. Welcome back. Now, you probably remember at the beginning of the show, I selected three contestants from our audience. Three ordinary people, sent them out into the streets of Hollywood in a limousine to the Chinese Theater, Man's Chinese Theater here in town, to find their own lookalikes. We're bringing out Jack Blackwood now. Let's see what kind of success he had. All right. Somebody on our staff is pulling my leg here. Did you actually find this gentleman?
I
didn't set this up on our show. Come on, producers, did we set this? We didn't. What would you do, bring an extra red shirt with you? Ladies and gentlemen, the Smith Brothers right here on our show. You two are married, right?
Right.
Okay. And your name, Charmaine, right?
Right.
Do you ever get caught squeezing the Charmaine? I couldn't help it. John. Your consequence involves kissing Angeline right on the old lips there. And if you do that, you're going to get $500. And it looks like he's about five stories up. John, tell, what's it look like from up there?
Okay.
Yeah, I bet.
I'm not going to look down, though. Hey, I'm getting there.
Is it? Yeah, I can see. John?
I'm getting close.
John, I don't know. I don't know if you heard me correctly. I said the lips.
Oh.
Claudia, look, isn't he cute? Well, this is little Topo Gigio the Fourth. All right, now, he's in one of these four boxes, and so is a $100 bill. Ooh, I can't wait to see who gets the money. Won't this be fun? All right. You don't have any fear of him, I can tell.
No.
God, we'll just dive right in there.
All
go
right.
Ahead. Look at that. Look at no fear whatsoever. Oh, who put that in there? What is this? Claudia! Let's go, Claudia. Why? We haven't found the 100 and we haven't found little Topo, so guess what that means. Let's take that hand and just put it in there. And don't worry, his teeth, we dulled them just before the show, so we took a little piece. Go ahead. Oh, be great. All right. Yeah, feel around in that corner and don't look out on it. Oh, God. Kelly, stop that for crying out. She scared me, Kelly. Okay, reach in there, and whatever you do, don't let that long, wiggly little tail get in your way, okay? But feel... This has got a sail over here and a sail over there. And I assume this bar here is some sort of, is this where the pilot, what do you call it? The pilot of this?
I call him a pilot.
A pilot? Yeah. I was right. And then what do you do? Just move this back and forth and it makes the sails go left and right? Well, I would love to watch you do this. Really, I would. I'm not getting in it. There's no way in the world that I'm going to get caught dead in this thing. How fast does this go?
Yeah! I love the thrill of speed and the agony of getting wet.
I'm here at the Dolphin Quest Learning Center Lagoon. And guess what I get to do? I'm going to get wet with, you guessed it, a dolphin.
Get wet, Pele.
How do you say get wet, Pele? Thank you. I knew you could.
I'm going to experience parasailing. I'm with Ken and Vicky, and they promised me I can enjoy the sky and the beauty of Hawaii and not get wet, right?
Yeah! Up! Up! No, up! Wait a minute. Hey! I wasn't supposed to get wet!
They lied to me. They lied to me.
Everybody should see the world like this.
Okay.
Cross over.
There you go.
Pull it in. Let her out.
Look where you're going.
Look where I'm going. I did. I looked right where I was going. Now. So, I think I've proven once and for all that any idiot can do this sport. All it takes is agility, coordination, and a little bit of guts.
The highlight of my career, my first series. Getting the first series, the same sort of optimism. I finally made it. I paid all the dues. Finally, somebody has hired me and they're putting me in a regular series. I'm going to be on every week. I'm going to get a regular paycheck. And that all happened for 13 weeks.
Mine was the Gong Show.
Or was it Midnight Express? No, or was it rock concert?
What was your first series?
It was a little known college fraternity's sorority thing called Brothers and Sisters, which came on the heels of Animal House.
What do you think of when you make a show?
I think you could never really make me smile. They almost made me smile. They could never really make me smile. That's the thing about Shecky is there was no greater fan of Shecky's than Shecky. I was always amazed and entertained and quite delighted by the fact that he thought he's really felt me special. And that made him in some way special to me, because...
A beacon of loserness in the night?
Yeah. A beacon of loserness in the night, and proud of it. I'm not afraid to admit it. No?
Pat says he's not just God's gift to women, he is the grand prize.
What's your favorite Shecky story?
My favorite Shecky story? I don't really have
it.
There's nothing about Shecky.
You are?
I'm Pat.
Pat.
You're Stacy, right?
Yeah, I'm Stacy.
May I call you Stacy?
No.
What would you like me to call you? When you make love to yourself, you're making love to somebody you really like.
Do you ever tell her when you were making love to a woman, do you ever tell she is, how excited you are by being with her?
Sure. Absolutely. I just hope I get the name right.
There's nothing about Shecky. I think it's his mode and style of entertaining.
You're one of the most fascinating women I've ever met in my entire life. With the biggest smile.
Hey, sports fans, we're here to tell you about Scorebig, the great new sports memorabilia show, which is on Fridays from midnight to 2. I'm John Coleman, the Merchant of Memories, and my buddy Brian here, the King of Sports, is going to tell you about one of the great deals you'll see. We're going to give you a chance to get your piece of the sports rock with incredible deals. We'll have sports trivia, and as an added attraction, we're going to have Lillian Miller, Playboy's number one model and cover girl. If you like sports, if you listen to sports talk radio, if you collect sports memorabilia for fun or profit, you've got to see this show. Friday, midnight to 2. Be there.